Our scripture lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 25, starting in verse 14. If you'd like to follow along in your pew Bibles, it begins on page 807. Listen now for God's word. For it is as if a man going on a journey summoned his slaves and entrusted his property to them. To one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, to another 1. To each according to his ability. Then he went away. The one who had received the 5 talents went off at once and traded with them and made 5 more talents. In the same way, the one who had the 2 talents made 2 more talents. But the one who had received the 1 talent went off and dug a hole in the ground and hid his master's money. After a long time, the master of those slaves came and settled accounts with them. Then the one who had received the 5 talents came forward, bringing 5 more talents, saying, Master, you handed over to me 5 talents. See, I have made 5 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. And the one with the 2 talents also came forward, saying, Master, you handed over to me 2 talents. See, I have made 2 more talents. His master said to him, Well done, good and trustworthy slave. You have been trustworthy in a few things. I will put you in charge of many things. Enter into the joy of your master. Then the one who had received the 1 talent also came forward, saying, Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here you have what is yours. But his master replied, You wicked and lazy slave, you knew, did you, that I reap where I did not sow and gather where I did not scatter? Then you ought to have invested my money with the bankers, and on my return, I would have received what was my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to the one with the 10 talents. For to all those who have, more will be given, and they will have an abundance. But from those who have nothing, even what they have will be taken away. As for this worthless slave, throw him into the outer darkness where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Friends, this too is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Before I begin, can I thank you all for these wonderful 4 weeks that David and I have enjoyed in your company. Thank you for your warm welcome. It's been a pleasure to get to know you even a little and to spend time in your company and to worship with you. I chose these disturbing parables for these 3 Sundays because I hoped they would stretch us, provoke us, and most of all, help us think about what it is to be Jesus' people in today's world. If you went home and said, I need to think some more about that, or even, I really disagree with that awful preacher from Scotland, good, good, the parable made you think. Job done. As well as taking comfort from Scripture, we need to be disrupted from our usual assumptions and learned ways of seeing things so we can reevaluate who the gospel is calling us to be in our own time. The parable of the talents can at one and the same time be an encouragement to us, and yet it has a particularly disturbing ending, focused on judgment. We may not usually think of God in these stark mythological terms, as someone who would throw us into eternal darkness and turmoil. But in this typically Matthean story of judgment, with all of its startling hyperbole, there remains a clear message that we need to urgently consider how we live in this world. How we live and the choices we make about what we use, what we have. They affect people. They affect the world around us. It really, really does matter. If in some more conservative circles this parable is read as us having to give an account for how we live at an end time, I want to say this. Why wait? Why don't we all think about how we live this very day and how it plays out there with our neighbours together? Now, not at some final judgment. An allegorical reading of this parable frames God as a slave owner, something we understandably will feel extremely uncomfortable about, but which would have made sense in the Greco-Roman context of Jesus' time. In the story, the owner remarkably goes on to entrust his great treasure to his slaves. And it is a ridiculous and unbelievably generous amount that he entrusts them with. Thomas Long reminds us that even the third slave who only receives one talent receives a lavish amount of treasure. 15 years of income for one worker. Can you imagine 15 years of earning? So obviously then, this story is full of exaggerated hyperbole, but to make a very important and serious point to all of us. The first slave receives 5 talents, and the second 3. These are unbelievable amounts to be entrusted with, ridiculous. But then, the last 2 weeks' parables have taught us, haven't they, about the breathless generosity of God towards us in love, forgiveness, acceptance. A God whose grace and goodness is beyond all measure, beyond counting. A God whose generosity stretches beyond our notions, even of justice. Well, here we are again in the gospel, with a description of the God we meet in Jesus Christ, the one who is generous beyond measure. The first 2 slaves are bold and courageous. They get out there into the world and they trade with the treasure that they are given. They invest the abundance that they have received. Out there in the messy world that we all know, and it comes back to them. 5 talents into 10 talents, 2 into 4. The abundance has grown and flourished in God's good world. But the third slave, not so much. His mistake is that he fundamentally misunderstands the character of the one who has given him this generous talent. Even despite all the generosity he has been entrusted with, 15 years of wages, in reply to this generosity, he says, "Master, I knew that you were a harsh man, reaping where you did not sow and gathering where you did not scatter seed. So I was afraid and I went and hid your talent in the ground. Here, have what is yours." For those of us who grew up fearing God, and I really mean in the sense of fearing as opposed to revering, it's difficult not to have a modicum of sympathy for this third guy in the parable, who, along with a hyperbolic abundance, receives a hyperbolic fate. Look, he was afraid. He thought he'd better play safe than be sorry. What if he traded his treasure and got less in return? What if he'd made a loss? Help us. What might have happened then? Well, it's an open question, and explicitly at least, it remains unanswered in the parable. But any of us who grew up in part revering God, but also maybe fearing God, we can understand his anxiety, can't we? Fear is a terrible thing. Fear, it keeps us safe at times, stops us getting into dangerous situations, but when it overtakes us, when it dominates us, when it overwhelms us, fear can be damaging beyond measure. It can warp the way we see the world and other people around us. Overblown fear of our neighbours can have terrible and damaging consequences. It distorts the way we see them. It makes us suspicious of them and doubtful of their motives and character. Fear blows up the differences between us and others and twists them into a source of anxiety and worry. Our imagination begins to run wild. We make all kinds of terrible assumptions about those other people. It's the oldest human disease in history, and no good has ever come of it. Friends, whatever faith is about, I have learned on my walk with Jesus that faith is not about fearing God. Respecting the one who gives us life, yes, absolutely. Revering the one who comes to us in Jesus Christ and whose spirit strengthens us and encourages us to live out the gospel in the world, absolutely. But fear as in terror of or frightened of, no. Don't take my word for it. The writer of the first letter of John reminds us. He writes, "Beloved, let us love one another, because love is from God. Everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, for God is love." God's love was revealed among us in this way. God sent his only Son into the world so that we might live through him. And he goes on to say, "Love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness on the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. For fear has to do with punishment, and whoever fears has not reached perfection in love. We love because God first loved us." Fear only paralyzes us and curtails our ability to live in the freedom of the gospel. Love, on the other hand, sets us free to be brave and courageous in sharing this abundance that we have all been given. For sure, there's a work of discernment to be done in how we live, what we do, how we live with our neighbor, of course. And that's what community is for, to give us the discipline and the benefit of figuring things out together in the wisdom of God's Spirit. But never forget, we love because God first loved us. That's all you need to know. Let that knowledge in the year ahead of your church work and programs, your ministry and your mission here in your community, set you free to live out the gospel in your community, at home, at work, at school, wherever life's road takes you. Take risks for the gospel. Don't be tempted to play it safe. Friends, we have been given by God an abundance beyond measure, the good news of Jesus Christ and his love for the world. Don't be like the last guy, filled with fear, but instead like the first two who took the gospel and invested it with abandon in the world. Don't worry about how it will turn out. Don't worry if you make some mistakes along the way. Trust in the abundance of the one who has given you all good things. Maya Angelou once said, "Difficult is a far cry from impossible. The distance between these two lies hope. Hope and fear cannot occupy the same space at the same time. Invite one to stay. Friends, this parable is not a gentle tale about what Christians do with their individual gifts and talents, as helpful as that might have been. But it's a disturbing story about what we as Christians do or do not do with the gospel of love while we wait for the fullness of God's reign in the world. And to be sure, this time we live in requires bravery and courage. In a world marred by mistrust and suspicion, fear and demonizing of the other, it's difficult to be the one who refuses to join in the sometimes all too casual xenophobia of our time. Or to be the one who refuses to stay silent when inflammatory language is used about other people. Or to be the one who reaches out to the other side of the family whose politics you cannot abide. But we have to do it. It's a rough world we're all living in right now, whichever side of the Atlantic you live on. It's also difficult, I think, to be the person who refuses to give up on hope. In the midst of despondency about the future, the one who keeps getting up every day, hoping for better and working for better. It's hard to be that person at work or at church that keeps bringing the lens of hope to what can feel like a challenging world. It's hard in the face of hate and fear to stay the course of love, reconciliation, and forgiveness. These gospels can sometimes seem naive, frankly, in a brutal world. But you know, Jesus came under this very same accusation. His family thought he was mad at first, while others recognized the transformation his love could bring, and they didn't want that change. But still, Jesus persevered. He met with outcasts and lepers and had dinners with Roman collaborators and sex workers. Why? Because there is no fear in love. But perfect love casts out fear. We love because God first loved us. Friends, never forget that this matters. It matters, and it matters here with you in your life together. The gospel is not for the staff to do, the church to do, the pastors to do. It's for all of us to do together. And here's the disturbing part of this parable that there's really no running away from. This good news, this love, really matters. It matters to God, and it can transform our world. This love we meet in Jesus Christ, this abundance we have been given by God, is an abundance beyond measure. This love can change and transform the world, home by home, family by family, friendship by friendship, community by community. And we have been entrusted with it. Never underestimate the difference your love and care, your hope and healing can bring to the lives of other people. You may never know. You may never know how the abundance that you give plays out for good in the lives of other people. But it will. 5 will become 10. 2 will become 4. Even if we have only been given one talent of this perfect love, it can double and treble and quadruple and so on. Perfect love has cast out all fear. Let us go then from this place and live out the good news in God's world. And remember, we love because God first loved us. Amen.